First, a warm welcome to one and all on behalf of Gujarat Forensic Sciences University. Gujarat Forensic Sciences University, being a pioneer in the field of forensic sciences, is hosting a series of webinars focused on some emerging areas of forensics and allied sciences. I consider it a great honor to welcome Dr. Julian Bijold on this Google Meet platform. He has worked more than 25 years at the Netherlands Forensic Institute on innovative applications of ICT in forensic science, in combination with forensic casework. Presently, he is working at the Leiden University of Applied Sciences on innovative applications of ICT in crime scene investigation, in combining with teaching students about the same topic. He has been a chairman of European Working Group for Digital Imaging in the period of 1998 to 2012. Before I hand over the platform to sir, I would request again everyone to keep their mic and camera off to have a smooth experience throughout. So the platform is all yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this introduction. Thank you, Subir, for organizing this webinar. And I will start sharing my screen. Moment, please. Yes, there it is. So I hope you will now see my PowerPoint slides.
Yes, sir, you can.
Thank you very much for the confirmation. First, I will tell a little bit about my history, and then I will give an overview of the talk, and I will, in the end, I will give a live demonstration. This is the official opening slide of the Leiden University of Applied Sciences. This is how I normally do a presentation. And I promised you to tell a little bit about the history. I've worked at the Netherlands Forensic Institute, and here you can see the building in The Hague, very big building. And my little lab for digital imaging was at this site on the second floor. In the past 2008, I got interested in crime scene investigation and applications of automated video analysis. And I participated in a huge project of the University of Amsterdam with this topic. And you can see in 2008, we didn't have very advanced technology. This is just a simple burglary camera. And I mounted it on a head. And that's how I started experiments in simulated crime scenes with the police. In 2012, we got funding for a huge project with companies and a number of universities, and the name of the project was CSI The Hague. And the aim of this project was to do a demonstration of possibilities of existing technology. And here I am playing with
just a minute, Julian. Chaudhary, yes, sir. I would request you to off your microphones and camera, please. You're disturbing the session. Thank you. Thank you.
What you see here in this slide is a prototype of a mixed reality glasses. I am wearing here a rucksack with a heavy laptop computer. And this was developed by the Technical University of Delft. And this is almost something like the HoloLens. I will demonstrate later. In 2011, I was invited to Gujarat Forensic Sciences University. I gave lots of lectures about video analysis, but my topic has changed now. Now I am working on innovation in crime scene investigation. And 2 years ago, I had to leave the Netherlands Forensic Institute, and I got the opportunity to become a teacher and investigator at the Leiden University of Applied Sciences. This is the Faculty of Computer Sciences. We are running bachelor programs for software engineering, interaction technology, business data administration, and forensic ICT. Well, this is a very nice building, but it's not our building. We are just renting a number of floors, and we are here on floors 4, 5, 6, 7, only in a small part of this building. In the rest of the building are a number of different companies and organizations. We also have a little laboratory, and that's in a building in The Hague. Again, a huge building where lots of companies rent spaces. And we only have two spaces, one for the teachers and one we organize as a little lab for 10 people. And here you can see the HoloLens. In this lab, the name of the lab is the Internet of Things Lab. And students can investigate and do experiments with hardware. And I have to be careful because maybe they want to take apart my HoloLens. So I'm very, I have to protect my HoloLenses against these students. Of course, that was a joke. In this lab, we do prototype testing. We look at digital traces left by all kinds of devices. We do reverse engineering and lots of experiments. So students can do their little projects and they can also do internships with the companies that are also doing ICT in their building. These are the topics of the presentation. I will talk about real crime scenes and the difficulties for crime scene officers. And then what can we actually do with mixed reality to help them? So I will talk about CSI applications. I will talk about applications for training and education, and also for doing presentations in a courtroom. First, I will show you a crime scene, or maybe a scene. Maybe it is not a crime scene. It's just a scene. And the problem is it safe? And another problem is, what do we understand what we are seeing? What is this for a place? If you are a crime scene officer, you have a task to investigate. But what do you know about your assignment, about your job? Is it safe for you? What could be useful traces? Is it possible to walk over there? Do you understand all these chemicals, all these devices? I think most crime scene officers need help. They need advice from experts. And then, of course, the problem is, where are these experts? And how can I communicate with them? A similar scene. Again, lots of equipment. And again, we are not sure if it is safe. Here, in an industrial environment, there might be digital evidence in all these instruments. Could it be used? We are not sure. And what about this scene? There might still be victims, but it's not safe for yourself. And how can we make a plan to organize the work? You cannot walk over there. It will be very difficult to organize the work. It will be difficult to organize help, and it will also be very difficult to organize a proper forensic investigation. So how to do the planning? And here, this is a chemical plant with lots of damage from burning. And what do we know about arson and explosions? So again, we need help from experts. But maybe these experts are not there, and maybe they are not available at that moment. So we can do phone calls, of course. We can send around photo pictures. But then there will be questions about the safety and security of sending pictures over the internet. So again, we have lots of problems. And for all these scenes I've shown to you, we are not sure if they are actually crime scenes. Maybe they are just accidents. So this is a more familiar image. This is a normal crime scene. And we see already that it's not like the scenes of 20 years ago. Since we have possibilities with DNA, we have to take care of contamination. And so it's actually not normal work anymore. We have to work in these white suits and gloves, and we need to clean our equipment, our tools, and it's not easy anymore. Another problem is that DNA can be in micro traces, traces that you cannot see. In classical crime scene investigation, it was obvious where the traces are. It was blood, or it was damage, or it was bullet holes, or bullets, cartridges. You could find a knife. That was easy. Also, it was also easy to do the photography. But now we are dealing with invisible traces. And we have to work in these suits with hand gloves, and we only have two hands. So who is taking these pictures? There must be a second person to do this. We also need forensic lights to make micro traces visible. But if you take a picture with such a light, it looks like a black image. And in the office, if you look at this image, you have no clue where it is actually. You cannot understand this black picture if you cannot make a relation with this image. So the organization of crime scene documentation has become more difficult, more complicated. We also have...
Julian, sorry to interrupt you, Julian. Your presentation is not visible.
What is happening?
The presentation
no,
is
no,
not...
it is visible.
It's visible?
It's not,
okay, fine.
Yeah,
okay, thank you. Sorry to interrupt.
No problem. Okay. There might be surprises if you do a crime scene investigation. Normally, there's a fixed plan. In the Netherlands, we talk about four stages. First, you do a reconnaissance of the scene. You just walk around with your hands on your back, and you make lots of observations. Then you make a plan with your colleagues. Then you start collecting the traces, and you do the photography and the analysis of what you found. But this, there could be surprises if you change the scene. For instance, in this series of images, a blanket is lifted, and suddenly they find herbal traces, grass, pieces of grass. So it might be necessary to rethink the plan of investigation and how to document such events. It's not easy anymore. You also do a lot of testing on the crime scene. For instance, this is a test if that red spot could be real blood. But again, we have to work in these white suits with hand gloves, and who is doing the documentation and the photography. And finally, we are doing the collect. We do a swap, and it has to be dealt with in a proper way. We have to take care of the chain of custody, and in this case, the swap is put in a tube with a barcode. That helps, of course, but there will still be some work left after the crime scene investigation. What about the situation in the courtroom? In our courtrooms, the case files come in like this. It's still paper, lots of paper. Most of our crime courtrooms now have work with digital case files, but they are still text files. It's maybe not paper, but it's still something like this, lots of text. And there might be separate sheets with photographs. But it will be difficult, or it's always a lot of work to find the relations between the photographs and the information in the text. This is a moot courtroom session with our students. This is how our students experience what happens in the courtroom. These are students in forensic ICT. But the situation is still like this. Because the technology is changing all the time and the possibilities of tracing are also changing all the time, crime scene officers need new education, new training, and they have to do it repeatedly. How do they the training? Normally they work on simulated crime scenes. And in every police office, you can find something like this. It's not a professional simulated crime scene. They work with whatever room is available and with whatever furniture they can get. In this room, you can also see that the floor is dirty because in the past they did exercise with blood and it was difficult to clean it. So in all simulated crime scenes, for training and education, you see problems like this. They get dirty. This is an example of a virtual training in the same space you have seen. This was prepared for the University of Amsterdam, the department, the Faculty of Forensic Investigations. It's a very simple application. You simply type in your name, student. And this is the entrance of the same simulated crime scene. This is a clean scene. And now you can enter. But every student should know, every crime scene officer should know, you should not simply enter. It's better to look first around. You can see there's a window. There might be shoe prints, shoe marks over here. Maybe they are. Maybe I can better make a note of that. Shoe marks. No, it's on the wrong spot. I cannot change that anymore. Okay. I made a mistake. I entered the clean scene. I wanted to enter the real crime scene. So I have to go back. I'm going outside again. And you see the door doesn't open immediately because I have to check first what's in front of the door. Now I can make a note again, see it in the proper place, shoe marks. Still there, I don't understand it. Entering, I can look around, it's not much. I'll take a next step. Now I can look around. I can also take a lower position. Take some time. So this is actually a virtual tour, but we use it as an exercise for students. Before they do an exercise on the physical crime scene, they do an exercise in this virtual copy first. They cannot walk immediately to the victim. They have to walk around. They are forced to walk around, like in a real crime scene investigation. And they can make notes. Let's see if it works this time. It's on the right spot. So every student can do this. All the information is stored in a cookie, and you can visualize it like this. This is the time. So after 46 seconds, I made a comment at the start position about shoe marks. Then I went back to the start and I entered again, but this time to the real crime scene. And you see, I entered after 92 seconds again a comment about the shoe marks. And in the end, I made a comment about the cards. So the student can give this information to the teacher, and then they can do an evaluation of this work. Very simple. I will go back to the PowerPoint. It's also possible to make a physical simulated crime scene with material from exhibitions. And then it looks like this. Now we have also a portable crime scene. With a truck, you could bring this crime scene to different cities, to different police organizations, to do the same training or the same exercise. But of course, it takes more effort. Then we are slowly coming to the real topic, the HoloLens, but first a little bit more information about innovation. I mentioned already the CSI The Hague project, and in this project there was also an idea for a crime scene investigation experience lab. And this is how it was visualized. The idea was to work with physical materials and with big projections on the walls. So there might be movie recordings of traffic or people, crowds coming, or the weather changing. And this is the physical part of the scene where crime scene officers can do an exercise. And there was also the idea of monitoring this exercise with cameras. So the whole exercise was controlled from a special room where they could influence the circumstances on the simulated crime scene and where they could do all the recordings. This was the vision and this was how it was realized. It was actually a little street with four apartments like this. In one apartment was the simulated crime scene and in another apartment was the control room. And there were two walls on which we could project scene video recordings, but also images from serious gaming software. Well, this was a nice facility, but it was not nice for the Dutch police because they had to travel, do a lot of traveling for doing exercises here in this facility. So that's the reason why we stopped this facility. This is one of the last tests we did in this facility. Again, a mixed reality glass. You can see here an officer doing a virtual investigation of an simulated alleged drugs lab. And you can also see the heavy equipment on his back to make it work. So now I will do the real demo with the HoloLens. And most of these demonstrations have also been recorded in little movies. I've published most of these movies on LinkedIn, but you can also find them on this website. There's still not a proper website. This is a professional website. But anyway, you can find these video recordings. And the real paper is I have just submitted a real paper to the International Journal of Forensic Sciences. And now I will switch to the demonstration. I have to start up the HoloLens. You can see the HoloLens comes with a web interface. What you see now is the web interface. I have to wait a few moments because it's live. I will show you the live preview. There's a delay of about 4 or 5 seconds. So you see what I can see. So you are looking through my eyes at this moment. I'll make it a big screen. I will walk around. And there must be somewhere in the menu. You can see it. Maybe I should restart. I have to restart. Oh, there it is. Okay. You see a floating menu. You see, I'm controlling this menu with my hand.
Mr. Jesus Rao, please stop sharing your screen. Please, sir. It's creating a problem, sir. Mr. Jesus Rao.
It's working?
Julian, your screen is not visible. Somebody else has shared his screen. You again share your screen, Julian. Again. It's not visible. Now you can again share.
It's okay?
Yeah. Now we can see it. Yes.
Yes, sir.
I request all not to share their own screen. It is creating a problem in the webinar. Please don't share your screen, sir.
Okay. It is menu. It's the movements of my finger. Start the application. You see the menu changes. Now you may wonder, how does it work? How is it possible that this menu stays on this position? Well, HoloLens is continuously scanning the environment. I showed this. I showed you what it is actually doing. Remember, there's a delay of 2 or 3 seconds between what I see and what you see. But I hope you can now see a white mesh on top of my living room. Move slowly. You can see my chair, my laptop. If I move a chair, you will see the mesh will be updated. But this is what the HoloLens is continuously doing. It's scanning the environment, it tries to compute a mesh. And based on this mesh, it computes a coordinate system, and that's used for placing menus in virtual reality like this. I will stop the display of the mesh. Now, what can I do with this? I can this grind screen. I see a footprint over here.
Mr. Pityanga, please close your microphone. It is creating a problem.
Maybe I want to place a virtual. Place number over here.
run academic more. This numbers maybe what's interesting in this crime scene. So I will not move around in this crime scene. I stay in this position. I can do this anywhere. So there's a kettle over here. No idea if it's related to a crime scene or to a crime, but anyway, I will use it. I can place another one. Number of bottles. I could make it bigger or smaller. So you see, I have digital page numbers, and I can also make a photograph of it. But because I have a video link with you, I cannot take a photograph live. But if I take a photograph, the photo will appear in this yellow square. And again, I can make it bigger or smaller. I will delete this one. And I can also make video recordings. They will also be available. Now I will move to a special type of traces. Blood spatters. You see that we were talking about simulated crime scenes, but how to make realistic blood spatter traces. Well, you can't, but you can do experiments to make realistic blood spatter patterns. And here I've printed a pattern that was created by the University of Iowa. It's available on the internet. There's a nice description of the experiment. It's an impact pattern. You can print it and you can bring it to your simulated crime scene. The impact has happened somewhere here. And you can see there's a typical pattern in it. You can see directional information. You can also see it in individual blood spots. Now, there's a very classical technique to estimate the point of impact by attaching little ropes to each blood spot and to connect it somewhere on the floor. There's a lot of work. They call this technique stringing. In the HoloLens, I can also do it in a virtual way, very easy. A marker, here's my impact pattern, impact, I connect individual tests. I need to do this for a large number of spots. Because you have to move up around on the crime scene because you have to move close to do the proper inspection of what you're doing. Now I can move around. I can do a visual check. This is the time to turn this off. I can move closer. So this is what I call visual streaming. This is another pattern, also print out. That is very good print. So I can also put the marker over there.
Julian, sorry to interrupt you. There is like your voice is fumbling. The voice is not clear. Can you do something? Because we cannot hear.
And maybe I should move closer to my laptop.
That will be great because the voice is fumbling. People can't hear you.
Okay.
Thank you.
What happens if I cannot find my menus anymore? Oh, I closed the app. Made a mistake. I stopped the application, so I lost my phrases except for the strings. Not a real big problem. I will show you another application, another demo. I can also put a little signs. Look what happens if I move it through the wall. But this is what we call mixed reality. This gives you the impression. And that a real mix of reality and virtual reality. I can also bring in I can bring in a virtual victim. It's not perfect, it's not easy to manipulate. This is how I can do some testing of ideas of what could have happened over there. But the impact, the blood spread pattern, might be caused by a hit on his head in this position. And I can make a photograph of it. And I can use it in my report. Then in the court, I can also do something nice. My house. I can put it on the table. And of course, you want to look what's inside. That's why I need this button. If I look, come close to this house, you see it opens. So in a court session, the audience and the judges can look to a big screen, and the judge can give instructions to the one with the HoloLens and can ask him to walk around this crime scene and to show what's inside in every room. This could be a nice courtroom application. It's also possible to do to give them a real virtual reality impression of this house. That might be confusing. I will show you. I think I will not use this in court because it's too confusing. But I can also show this house in a real size. You it's a mixture of reality, virtual reality. So you look at a copy of my room in the real room. They are not aligned. But that's why it's so confusing. And I can also see that it's not on the same height, not in the same orientation. So I need a lot of controls to correct it. But in theory, it's possible to align this virtual room with a real room. Actually, I can do it with the whole house, and then I can walk around in the physical house while I'm looking at the virtual copy. That's a strange experience, but I will not try to do it now. And this must be a bug that is still there. What else can I show you? For the other demonstrations, I will use photos and video. So I will come back to you. I'll start up again the PowerPoint. So this is the ID again. You can place virtual markers. It's possible for the police to watch what he is doing from a distance. It's using a Wi-Fi network. This is a video recording because you can also work with multiple HoloLenses. And in multiple HoloLenses, you can also see the virtual marks that other persons introduce. And this recording, it was recorded from one of the two HoloLenses. And I will play
it. Ramanganath, sir, please, can you turn off your video? Yes, you can continue, Julian.
Okay.
Thank you.
This is a marker in an image, and that can be recognized by the HoloLens. And as soon as it is recognized, and button will be visible, and then you can see a virtual reconstruction of the bullet trajectory. I can insert this marker also in an other bullet hole. You see, it's not a real bullet hole. There's a button visible, not for the second HoloLens, but for the one you can see. And now we have two bullet trajectories. Of course, these are estimations and they have to be verified by a real ballistic expert. So that's why there's also a warning or a question mark to put in the photographs. You can see this is an old version of the software, old style menus. There's somewhere a point where these trajectories come together, so they might be in position for the shooter where he could shoot at both chairs. And of course, I can bring in a virtual shooter. And there might be gunshot residues on his sleeves. So in this way, you can use the HoloLens for training, education, and crime scene documentation. What I didn't show you, it's also possible to, I talked about the photography and the video. It appeared to be useful for sharing information for investigators and first responders that don't arrive at the same time on the crime scene. So for instance, this blood stain analysis could have been performed by a real expert on day one, and he can leave photographs or a video for other investigators coming at day two. So in this way, it's possible to do briefing
And you can also, it also helps with discussions. With HoloLens, you can also film your own actions, like sampling of bloodstains. And it can also do barcode recognition. So your photographs will have immediately an file name with the evidence number in it. There are always questions about working outside. With the HoloLens, there will be lots of problems with direct sunlight. But another problem is that if there is not enough spatial information in the scene, like on a square, on a big road, the HoloLens will literally get lost. It will not be able to compute a coordinate system. But if there are enough markers like this in the street or in places like that, it can still work outside. The direct sunlight is still a problem. Now, what about the future? I've created lots of demo applications, but I'm not sure what is really useful for the police. So we need to do more user tests. And it's not easy to organize user tests because it's not easy to get HoloLenses. The production is limited, the demand is high, and Microsoft cannot deliver. So it will take some time to organize these user tests. It's also possible to operate the menus with your voice commands. So I will do more testing with voice control. And I think I will focus on applications for training and education. And the idea is to work with a little mobile crime scenes that are very simple, just empty walls and floors, and you can bring in furniture with virtual reality. But you can, on these walls and floors, you can introduce physical traces. And I want to do more experiments with cloud services for image recognition. So it will be possible in the future to help crime scene officers with advice and information from databases from other crimes, just based on image recognition. I'm doing this work in a bachelor program, and I had the opportunity to develop a half-year course in which students can do lots of experiments, and in which students can also make little applications that I can use for my work. So what's the idea of this course? They learn what a CSI officer should know and what they should do and what they should learn. They also learn what the possibilities and limitations are of simulated virtual and mixed reality, and actually whatever is needed for developing a mixed reality application. It's a 10-week program of lectures, workshops, and practical assignments to get the necessary basic knowledge and skills. And another 10 weeks for developing and executing a small project. And it's combined with the possibility to work, to do their own study and experiments. And for that, there are 200 hours available in this program. They work with 3DS Studio Max for modeling. They work with Unity. That's the software for creating the software I have shown you. And they learn about some basics about crime scene investigation and forensics. And I organize lots of meetings with professionals from the field to get ideas for developing these projects. And that concludes my presentation. Thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to all your questions.
Thank you, Julian, for the wonderful presentation. The house is open for the questions. Kindly post the questions in the chat box and they will be answered one by one. Julian, we are waiting for the questions to arrive.
Yeah, I understand this.
Yeah.
People need some time to process all this information.
Yes.
Okay, so we have a the question states that if this software provides information about reconstructions and evidence is to speak out.
I'm not using this software for making models of the crime scene because this mesh is not very accurate. The HoloLens is trying to update this mesh over time, that the resolution, spatial resolution, is not very high. This mesh is used just for placing virtual reality. It's not accurate enough for making models of a crime scene. So, but you can do, but I think it's very nice tool for making annotated photographs of the crime scene. But for reconstructions, spatial reconstructions, I still recommend to use a laser scanner or to do proper forensic photography.
Thank you, Dr. Julian. We have one more question that is, kindly share your knowledge and experience to examine a scene involving mass disaster having multiple casualties.
Well, this HoloLens has never been used in real crime scenes. It's all experimental. But I can, I have some experience with big incidents and mass disaster scenes. In the past, I worked on a video analysis and I did a project on computer-assisted analysis of huge amounts of video recordings in combination with three-dimensional models of cities or of the scene. So that's my experience. And I also looked at a number of bomb sites, explosion sites, bombing. But my job was to make court presentations using three-dimensional models. The HoloLens, if people are using the HoloLens, then it's possible for the team outside the scene to see and to like you did, they can watch live what the investigators are doing on the scene. And they can, the investigators on the scene can leave information for other people coming next, also with a HoloLens. It's also possible to put a HoloLens on a robot that you send in a crime scene. About the technology.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Ramesh, can you ask next question? I think he has
So we have a few more questions from YouTube as well. How is crime scene management different from crime scene investigation?
Is there a difference? Management is just about organizing the crime scene investigation.
Okay. We have one more, that is, what is the basis of numbering the evidences? We can do as choice, or what is the reason?
Yes, that's a nice question. Normally, they use it for administration purposes. They put an evidence number next to the evidence. They make a photograph, and that's used for the administration and for references in the reports. That's the classical use of these numbers. But I have discussed this virtual numbering with the police, and they came with a new ID for helping in discussions. You can also use these numbers for hypotheses about what has happened, or hypotheses about explanations for the traces. So you can assign a number to a number of evidence and traces that fits with one theory. So you can use numbers for series, and you can connect them with multiple strings to different evidence items. That would be a new application.
Okay, sir. We have a few more. It's like, can we look at the crime scene in real time and take action and able to reach suspect faster than the current mode? It's probably related to the technology that is being used.
Actually, there's a difference between the first responders, people offering help to the victims, and the people doing the investigations. First responders come first. But if you equip them in a HoloLens, it's possible for the investigators outside the scene to watch what the first responders are doing. And it's not working now, but in theory, it's also possible to put virtual information from a distance. If a crime scene investigator looks through the eyes of the first responder wearing the HoloLens, in theory, it's possible for the first responder to bring in already virtual information. I haven't realized that yet.
So there are many questions related to asking about what is the technology that you have used during the presentation.
The software is developed with the Unity software. Unity is free. There are different license schemes for this software, but it's very popular software for developing applications for mobile phones, for virtual reality glasses, and for the HoloLens. Actually, it's software for creating games. You can download it yourself and you can check what it's doing, but it's not easy to learn, but you will find many tutorials on the internet. For modeling, I use 3D Studio Max. There are free licenses for students. It's very professional software, but if you need to buy it, it's very expensive. And that's actually all I need and all I use. There's no other software involved, no other techniques involved.
Okay, sir. So we have a few more questions. Shall we take them?
Yes, Ramya, I can go ahead.
Okay. There is a question from Gautam Roy. If it is a suicide or murder, with this technology, can it be proved by reconstruction? Is it a murder or suicide? And they have just pinged a case for it.
What is your idea about using this technology? Because it's just a tool. I am not a professional crime scene investigator myself, so I need feedback from the real experts.
Okay, sir. There is one more question, that's on-site sketches versus HoloLens. Which has better admissibility in the court of law? On-site sketches versus HoloLens, which has better admissibility in the court of law?
It depends on the law system, I guess. Normally, the sketches and the photographs and information should support a reconstruction or an explanation for the traces and all the evidence that has been found. If it doesn't support it, it's not useful. In simple cases, and one photograph could be enough. in complicated cases or cases with many questions about the actions of the victim and the offender, then it might be necessary to make a very accurate reproduction of the scene. Sometimes you need a physical reproduction of the scene with millimeter accuracy, but it depends on what you have to prove. Normally, you see that an investigation starts with simple maps, simple photographs, and in the course of the investigation, then more questions come up. Investigation teams need more information and more accurate information. Of course, they try to work as efficiently as possible. So that means you don't want to start with a laser scanner. But in the end, maybe you need a laser scanner. But you try to postpone it. It all depends on the questions and on the reconstruction. How much you need.
Okay, so there is one more question from YouTube. Can MR be used in plane crash investigation? And if yes, then how?
Plane crashes is an outside situation. So I think the HoloLens will not be able to make a coordinate system for the complete scene. It can be used, I think, on parts of the scene. A wing section or a wheel section, just the nose of the plane, small areas, then it works fine. But the HoloLens can recognize the different scenes. So if you walk around the plane, it will notice that you enter another part that it has been before.
Okay, so there's a few more. As it is a digital technology, chances of alteration are high with the crime scenes within the AR. So any step towards it?
I missed your question. Can you repeat it?
Yes, sir. As it is a digital technology, chances of alteration are high with the crime scene within the AR. So any steps towards it?
I still don't understand the question. What is the concern?
Ramay, can I explain if you don't mind?
Yeah, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The person is asking, Julian, that because this is a digital technology, and you know that the digital technology are highly prone towards alterations, so can this be used in a more effective way, and how these alterations can be removed?
Okay, now I understand. I think you are. So the concern is about the security. The same applies, of course, to digital photography. Digital photographs can also be altered. I also had discussions about the security of the wireless connection with the HoloLens. And I found out that police organizations can have different opinions about that. But I can offer one technical solution. I've worked on it. It's possible to do within the software direct encryption of the images. So within the application, it's possible to do an encryption and also to compute an hash code to prove that the image has not been changed later.
Okay, sir. I hope that cleared the doubt. We have a last question, that is, how to rule out the possibility of post-SOC editing of HoloLens capture? 3D Studio Max to replace Reliance in the court of law.
That's similar to problems in digital photographs and other evidence. So you can use procedures like computing hash codes to prove that an image has not been changed, and the same applies to other information that you get from the HoloLens.
Okay, sir. There is still one more. How this technology can help in riot and bomb blast where there is a lot of destruction all over?
I missed your question. I'm sorry.
Yes, it says like how can this technology be helpful in riot scenarios and the bomb blast cases where there is destruction at all the places, I mean a vast destruction.
In bomb sites, safety is, for instance, an issue. You don't want to have many people at the same time on the scene. So you, with the HoloLens, you can organize this work in such a way that only one or two persons are on the scene. Other people can watch with a live link from a distance, and they can use the annotated visual photographs from the HoloLens. But for my first idea was to would be to use the HoloLens also for the court presentation, because you can link all your models to the 3D model of the bomb scene, and you can make a very nice courtroom presentation with the help of the HoloLens. In bomb scenes, accident scenes, it's always a problem in court to give everybody an understanding of the scene. So that's why you see often little maquettes of the scene.
So there is one more question. The question is, we can allow junior personnel at the crime scene and the experienced professional can support and suggest the juniors. Hopefully, this can reduce the cost. Is the person right? I mean, there is a question from Srikant. He is asking that if we allocate junior personnel at the crime scene and the experienced professionals can support and suggest the juniors. So can this reduce the cost?
Yes, that's the way to use it. That's why I'm also, I want to focus in the future on training and education purposes.
Okay.
I can introduce, for instance, virtual traces in a simulated crime scene. So there's no need to work with real blood. If I want to make juniors think about bloodstain patterns, I can bring in on a simulated crime scene virtual stain patterns that are only visible if they use, for instance, a virtual light source and if they are close enough.
Yeah,
it requires imagination to understand this. That's why I need more feedback from real users.
So there is one more last probably. That's from Dr. Raki Khanna. She is asking like to put some light on web shot construction and its utility. To have some insights on the web shot construction and its utility.
I missed the question. Can you try it again?
She wants to have some tips or the tricks from you for some. The web shot construction and its utility, the web module which you used during your presentation, it's probably related to the same. The browser module which you use for the HoloLens,
yes,
during the presentation.
The browser, I can show you actually. It's just a web link with an IP address. My HoloLens has an IP address from a local network, and that's how I connect with it. I will try to share again. You see, this is an IP address, 192.168.1.75. So there is a web server in the HoloLens, and that's how I can communicate with it. I can also show you something else. Because you asked about the scanning and the accuracy. So here you can see, I can update. So now I'm scanning my room. takes some time, you see. And now you can also see, if I make an export of this 3D model, it will be difficult to make a nice model of it. It's very rough. And it's also a Windows system. It's just an like a window. This is the application Forensic Toolbox number 14. Normal file system where the video and the pictures can be found. And you can download the pictures and the video and other information that's produced by your application. I hope this helps.
Yes, I probably. So I think other questions. Moving towards the end of the session, this was really a charismatic session which helped us to learn about new technologies and topics in all those entertaining ways with the hologram techniques and the ways you presented out the things. So on behalf of Gujarat Forensic Sciences University, sir, I would like to really thank you for taking out your time and sharing us with your immense knowledge. I would also like to thank all the participants tuned on all the platforms for attending this session. Thanks a lot, everyone.
Thank you very much for all your time and your attention.
Thank you very much, Julian, for sharing your valuable time and sharing your knowledge with us. And probably I have a question, the people are asking for your mail IDs and your contact details so that they can chat with you, or they can share their experience and can work with you on this particular virtual platform. So kindly, if possible, share your mail ID with them so that they can post their questions for you.
First, they can find me on LinkedIn.
Yeah, LinkedIn is a good platform where you people can find him. So kindly join him or send him a connection on LinkedIn, then you can have an interaction with him. Thank you so much, Julian. Thank you. Bye. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you all, and have a great day, everyone. Thank you, sir, for joining.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for the session.